bacteria often gets a bad rap. We're associated with being sick, with getting an infection. We're constantly told to wash our hands, to use hand sanitizer just to get rid of it, right? Well, despite our preconceptions, all bacteria is not bad. In fact, we wouldn't be alive today if it weren't for the pounds of bacteria that we have in our gut. So today we are going to talk about those good bacteria or probiotics and whether when you take an antibiotic, you should be taking a probiotic with it and why. But before we move on, please hit that subscribe button, like this video. All of that helps our video move up in organic search, helping us continue to make videos for you. So by the end of this video, you will have a better understanding of what antibiotics might be doing in the gut, whether taking a probiotic can reverse that damage, and if not, what a probiotic could help with during antibiotic treatment, so that when you might have to be put on a regimen at some point in your life of antibiotics, you are equipped with the knowledge and information to be able to help prevent the side effects of an antibiotic treatment as much as possible. So our microbiome is mostly in our large intestine, and it is composed of trillions of different bacteria, yeast, viruses, and other microorganisms. That whole community, that trillions of different organisms, mostly in our large intestine, actually weighs a few pounds. And it is estimated that we have 10 times as many bacteria in the body as human cells. So it really begs the question, you know, what are we, A? And then B, you might have heard of this whole gut-brain connection. Well, did you know that 90% of that gut-brain communication actually goes from the gut to the brain, and only 10% goes from the brain down to the gut? In fact, most of our serotonin production is produced in our gut. So to say that we should take care of our microbiome is really an understatement, given all this knowledge that you now have. So our microbiome starts right when we're born, and whether we were born via the vaginal canal or a C-section does affect the health of our microbiome right out of the gate. There's actually some interesting research being done for babies that have to be born C-section on whether wiping some of the mom's bacteria from her vaginal canal can help with the health of that child, despite not getting that from the C-section birth. So just kind of a side interesting note there. It's called vaginal seeding if you want to look into it. But everyone's microbiomes are different. What fascinates me the most about the microbiome is that it's always changing. So the foods that you ate 3 days ago could be changing the type of bacteria in your gut today, which is awesome as a dietitian, knowing that if we can just change the types of foods that we eat, that could help our microbiome be healthier, and that can help all sorts of things downstream. Like we talked about the gut-brain connection, there's research showing bacteria, you know, connected to how easy or hard it is to lose weight, to our immune system, of course, and lots of other things. This field of research is just exploding right now and will continue to explode. Based upon the research, there are a few things that we look at when considering whether somebody has a healthy microbiome, and that is stability, diversity, and resilience. So let's start by talking briefly about antibiotics. You've probably heard they're not the best, but they're certainly necessary, and the invention of antibiotics was a tremendous help for different things in the medical community. I want to preface this by saying I am not giving medical advice. Always check with your provider. As mentioned, sometimes antibiotics are necessary. I think that you should always make sure to be talking to your doctor, though, to make sure that in each individual instance, it really is necessary, because we have research showing how harmful it is for our gut microbiome. And the microbiome, as I just mentioned, the bacteria, the yeast, the viruses, the fungi, they all play a role together and can affect other things in the body. And if that gets off balance, and if that gets unhealthy, it could lead you to other different chronic health issues. So prevention certainly is what we always want. Now, one research study looked at amoxicillin, which is a commonly prescribed antibiotic, and it showed that the diversity of the gut microbiome decreased by 25% in individuals taking it, and the types of good bacteria strains went from 29 down to 12. So yes, it's killing the bad bacteria, but it's also killing some of the good bacteria too. The microbiome can recover, but what we're finding in the research is that it often can't recover to the spot that it was at prior to the antibiotic, which is why it's so important to always check with your doctor to make sure that when you're put on an antibiotic, it's absolutely necessary. Another 2-year study showed that after just a 7-day course of an antibiotic, and then they followed these people for 2 years, the microbiome did not recover. 2 years later, and there are still detrimental effects on the microbiome from just a 7-day course of an antibiotic. You know, how shocking is that? And it also showed that there was more antibiotic resistant bacteria in these people's microbiome, which certainly you don't want, because if you're, you know, getting into your older age and you have a lot of antibiotic resistant bacteria and you actually have a severe infection or issue that you need antibiotics to help with, and it's a life or death situation, you're going to want to make sure that you have a healthy microbiome. And that really starts with many, many years prior, making sure that we're caring for that microbiome. So, do you know what the 2 most common side effects from antibiotics are, symptom-wise? It's nausea and diarrhea. So, as mentioned in the title of this video, you are wondering whether probiotics, the probiotic supplements, can help with these side effects from the antibiotics. Let's talk about that next. So probiotic supplements are basically just these live bacteria strains that are in a capsule form. So you might find them refrigerated. Not all of them have to be refrigerated. Most do, but some of them do come in individual little packets that are just oxygen sealed so that they're much easier to travel with. And the research shows that actually, yes, even though, as mentioned, the microbiome can't fully recover, what we can do if you have to be put on an antibiotic is that we can use these probiotic supplements to help at least prevent you from having the common side effects of the nausea and the diarrhea. So the studies show that these side effects of nausea, diarrhea can last anywhere from days to 2 months after antibiotic treatment and can be anywhere from mild to severe. Probiotic supplements, the research has shown to help with that, but I do want to add to this, and if you've watched my other videos, you probably know this already, but supplements aren't regulated. So if you're just going to Costco, going to Walmart to buy your supplements, I really would encourage you to be careful, because you might be, you know, wasting your money at the safest side, and I have heard of people getting sick from buying supplements that aren't quality. So beware of that. As a dietitian, I research and I find good quality supplement brands and companies. And I will actually, after talking about these probiotics, I will link one in the description below that you might want to consider if you do have to be put on antibiotics at some point. So what the probiotics do is that the antibiotics coming in, right, killing the bad bacteria, also killing the good. But if we're taking some good probiotics, that can help with giving the body some of those good bacteria again to hopefully keep it more in balance than it would be without that probiotic supplement. One research study showed that the individuals who were taking an antibiotic and also taking a probiotic drink, their rate of developing diarrhea was reduced by 31% and their rate of nausea reduced by 49%. I would say that's a pretty safe intervention, and to especially decrease the side effect risk by that much. So that was a probiotic drink. We talked about probiotic supplements, and at this point I do want to share that probiotic supplements have in the billions of bacteria, but just one tablespoon of fermented food, which has live healthy bacteria in it. So those fermented foods, just one tablespoon, has in the trillions The research, of course, is done on these probiotic supplements and in this one, this drink, but know that difference as we don't have enough research yet, but maybe food would be sufficient in helping to prevent some of those side effects as well. So another research study of individuals taking those antibiotics were giving probiotic capsules 2 a day. And in the group that was given the 2 probiotic capsules a day, they only had diarrhea for an average of 2.8 days, while the non-probiotic group, it was an average of 6.4. So again, pretty significant results for a pretty safe intervention. So just to summarize, yes, probiotics can help to prevent your risk of getting diarrhea from the antibiotics and nausea, but it's still not going to totally get your microbiome back to what it was prior to the antibiotics. So still always ask with your doctor whether it's necessary. So let's talk a little bit more about those fermented foods that I mentioned, the bacteria containing fluids. The kombucha has been popular lately. Sauerkraut is a traditional one. There's kimchi, there's yogurts. Something to mention about the yogurt is that all of them don't have live active bacteria, because if it was heat treated and the bacteria wasn't added back, it's not gonna have it. And then also watch the added sugars to the yogurts too. And something to say about the sauerkraut and pickles too is that not all sauerkraut and pickles are fermented. So make sure you're looking for the label live active bacteria on it, and it's going to be in the refrigerated section, because if it's sitting on the shelf and if it's really fermented, it's going to keep fermenting in that warm temperature and the jar is going to explode. So it's kept in the fridge section to help slow down significantly that fermentation process. I always encourage trying to get in fermented vegetables. As mentioned, about 1 tablespoon at all your meals is all you need to get in trillions of these bacteria. So you can simply use a good fermented yogurt or add just some sauerkraut or some kimchi on top of your salad. So here are a few ideas for how to add in some fermented foods. As mentioned, the kimchi on a variety of different foods can be just quick and easy. I like Bubby's brand fermented pickles. You could just drink a tablespoon of the pickle juice or add a spear next to your meal. You can add some sauerkraut onto your sandwich. You could have some kombucha if you have, you know, sipping like in the afternoon if you just want something to sip on. Having the kombucha, Synergy brand has one with chia seeds, is kind of more bang for your buck, and you're getting some fiber from the chia seeds to help balance out the sugars from the kombucha, because it's a great fermented food, but it is one of the higher, you know, sugar fermented foods. So to help to balance your blood sugars out, choose the one with the chia seeds if both of them are equally as tasty to you. So as mentioned, I'm going to link a recommended probiotic supplement in the description below. I would just save that somewhere in case you ever do have to be put on a probiotic, so at least you have a good quality brand to buy from. And then also, if you are struggling with digestive issues, gas, bloating, diarrhea, constipation, you might be interested as well in our free guide, 5 Ways to Improve Gut Health and Get Rid of Food Intolerances for Good, also linked in the description. Now, I want to tune into a study that was done in 2018 that does complicate things a bit, and I will let you know why. So this study was really interesting. It was done on 21 people, and not only was the feces, the stool, checked for the microbiome changes, but also an endoscopy and a colonoscopy was done, which is basically putting a videoscope, you know, down the esophagus into the stomach, first part of the small intestine, and then up the other end to help monitor the changes. So these 21 people were put into 3 different groups. They're all given antibiotics. The first group was given nothing after the antibiotics. Second group given probiotics. Third group was actually given a fecal transplant of their own microbiome. So what they did is they took some of the stool, so some of the poop, from these people prior to the antibiotics, and then they did a fecal transplant with the same person's stool, so it's not a donor. And they wanted to see how that might help the microbiome. Again, microbiome, just that community of the bacteria and viruses and fungi, and yeast in our, mostly in our large intestine, how that would recover, help to recover after the antibiotic treatment. And the results were really interesting. What we found was that actually the individuals taking the probiotic capsule again after the course of antibiotics, it prevented their microbiome from recovering as well versus the individuals that were given nothing. So it might beg the question of us putting these beneficial bacteria into our gut, is that in some way preventing our gut's natural ability to help the natural bacteria regrow properly? So with the information that I've given you about how probiotics, there is good research showing that it can help prevent some of the side effects, the diarrhea, nausea, that we certainly know, especially when taking it during the antibiotic, it might be worthwhile not taking a probiotic supplement after the course of antibiotics based upon this research, which again is small, 21 individuals, but it's all we have right now. What I think is the more interesting part of this research study is that the individuals given the fecal transplant, their microbiome recovered really well, almost closer to what it was prior to the antibiotic. How amazing is that? Now, before you go start asking your doctor about this, it's not approved yet. The only way to get a fecal transplant approved in our country by the FDA in the United States is if somebody has a severe C. diff bacteria infection. But I think that this is really promising. And know that people have done homemade fecal transplants. People have actually died from doing homemade fecal transplants. So it's really something that you will have to be, you know, careful about and why it is regulated by the FDA in our country. And I will make a whole video about fecal transplants sometime soon because it seems like I get questions every single week about this. So I know that you guys are interested in it and I'll, you know, break it all down soon. But basically, to just summarize that whole 2018 study, yes, I think that taking some probiotic supplements during antibiotics makes total sense to prevent that nausea, diarrhea. But after that course is done, it might be worthwhile still incorporating some fermented foods, but holding off on the probiotic supplement. And then let's keep an eye out for research coming out on those fecal transplants, because maybe in the future what we do is when people have to be put on a course of antibiotics, we take some of their stool and then we transplant it after the course of antibiotics, which might prevent some of that damage that I told you can last for over 2 years from just the 7-day course. So I hope this video was helpful to you. Thank you so much for watching. Please comment all your questions below. And if you are interested in a video about fecal transplants, say yes FT or yes FMT or yes fecal transplant in the comments below, and post your questions that you have about them as well, because I can look through those questions then and make sure to answer them when I create that video. So I thank you so much and I hope you have a great day, and I will see you soon.